Welcome back. It's now time to go in depth. Now, on Monday, we began a discussion with LIAT CEO Captain Ian Brunton about some of the issues the airline has been facing, and as well as regional transportation issues. Well, those issues are so wide that we decided to continue discussion, and we have Captain Brunton back with us tonight. Well, we left off on Monday, Captain Brunton, with you calling on more regional governments to invest in LIAT and even subsidize the airline. On the issue of subsidies, Trinidad and Tobago subsidizes fuel to Caribbean Airlines, but that's been called unfair. Do you agree with that?
Hi, Kalilah. Well, it's not whether I agree or not. It's a question of if you look at the institutions, both CARICOM and in terms of the competition policies of the revised Treaty of Shagaramas, as well as the CARICOM Multilateral Air Services Agreement, both of those documents or institutions speak to unfair competition and so on. And the fuel subsidy, the legal opinions that have been obtained show that, yes, both of those institutions and paperwork, the agreements, are contravened by any kind of fuel subsidy. So it's not a question of whether I or individuals agree to it. That is something that will be taken up on many levels. It will be taken up on a legal level because there is a remedy at the Caribbean Court of Justice, which is what the Caribbean Court of Justice was established for. And also, of course, COTED, the CARICOM Council on Trade and Economic Development, has also a big interest in their competition commission and so on. They can give directives to individual states, and the competition commission of CARICOM can also take punitive action against states that exhibit anti-competitive policies. So there are a number of remedies are available, and they'll be taken up in those fora. But the point is, I think what we want to make sure is that we come to amicable agreements with the government of Trinidad and Tobago, and that is what our shareholder governments are attempting to do, because we are partners, and that hopefully will end in a very amicable way in the near future.
Mm-hmm. But then can you really blame Trinidad and Tobago for subsidizing CAL? Because what you have called for is subsidies from your own shareholder government. So if they were able to, you would want them to subsidize LIAT as well.
You can't blame any country for subsidizing what they see as an essential part of their economy. No, you can't. That's why I'm saying it's not up to individuals to say whether it's a good or a bad thing, or whether I should say it's a good or a bad thing. It's just, it's there. Their governments have to try and keep their economic policies in line with their national policy and so on. But if any of the instruments are contravened in the region, then there is recourse to places like the Caribbean Court of Justice and the COTED and so on.
So is it that you want the subsidy to end, or that you want LIAT to have access to the same subsidized rate of fuel that CAL has?
I really cannot answer that. It really depends on what these remedy organizations will determine, whichever way. It's not my preference as to what happens. It's indeed up to the third parties who have a remit to deal with these matters and to conciliate these matters, decide what is the fairest way to do it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, moving on to another issue, there was a tongue-in-cheek complaint letter about LIAT the other day that made international headlines. Now, I saw LIAT's video response, and I kind of felt like you responded by challenging the Virgin CEO, Sir Richard Branson, who actually publicized the letter, and you left the actual complaints for the back burner. Do you think LIAT should have handled that differently?
Yes, in retrospect, and in fact, what happened was that the videos went out in the wrong order. What happened was there are three dimensions of response to something like that, particularly when it involves somebody like Sir Richard Branson. He, as you know, is a very, I wouldn't say eccentric, but a singular type of personality in the entrepreneurial world. Everybody respects him and loves him for it because he deals with things at different levels. He has a penchant for dealing with things at a very sort of light-hearted and frivolous level. And so the three dimensions that we were going to address the situation with that letter. Let me go back a little bit and say that the letter, in fact, was really a bit of a frivolous comedic letter or stab or dig at LIAT. It wasn't meant to be serious. It was purely meant as a joke. And the writer of that letter has been in touch with us and has indicated that it was such. It wasn't meant to be serious. And in fact, there was no official complaint from that passenger about his trip. And there are a couple of things. There was no loss of a bag, as was indicated or hinted at in the letter, and that his planned schedule would have taken him past the time of the ferry departure anyway. So there was no major complaint that he had leveled at us. But unfortunately, it was published as well. I think he sent it himself to the BVI newspaper, and the Virgin chairman took it up and had a dig at us. which, you know, we feel is a little unfair because if another airline had done it to him, he wouldn't have liked it. So the three areas of address of that thing was the serious one to address, as you hinted at, the underlying issue of whether we really provided a bad service to that customer. And that was done. And there was a video about that and about what LIAT tries to do for its customers and how we care, which was done. But unfortunately, that came second in line to the first, the frivolous video. There's that frivolous level that is very, very good for publicity.
So did Sir Richard ever take up LIAT's challenge to race?
They were starting to, but we pulled it back. Because of the groundswell of opposition we got from our public here, we immediately, the same night we published it, we pulled it back because we realized that the public took it the wrong way. And that may have been our fault in terms of the sequence. That the first video should have been, or the first address to the public should have been the serious one about how we're investigating. We don't think we've done anything wrong. It was meant to be a joke by the passenger and so on. A brilliant joke, but a joke. And we were then going to address the frivolous dimension, which would have given us a tremendous amount of free publicity, worldwide free publicity. You can't pay for that. Mm-hmm. Certainly, LIAT can't afford to pay for that kind of publicity. We'd have ridden on the back of a fantastic worldwide airline like Virgin Atlantic and be able to get the kind of publicity for free that would have been available to us if the offer had been taken up and so on. Unfortunately, we had to shelve it because our public didn't understand. And I say we may have been to blame for not showing them that we were taking it at a serious level mm-hmm. as well. And we'll be forever regretful of that, really, because we lost that great opportunity to get free publicity.
So that kind of ended up backfiring in the end.
Yeah, but we owe nobody an apology for it, by the way. It was exactly the right thing to do, but as I say, the sequence of putting it out to our public was wrong, and that was the only thing that was wrong.
Another issue that I wanted to follow up on Monday we were discussing LIAT's refleeting exercise. Captain Carl Burke, he's the president of LIALPA, the union which represents some of LIAT's pilots, has said that the training of pilots for the new ATR planes has led to a shortage of manpower at LIAT. He says the crew is overworked and so on. Is that true? What's going on with that?
Well, to the extent that the crews are working very hard and running out of crew duty time, which is the duty time that they're allowed by the regulatory system, it's obviously the aviation is highly regulated, particularly with a view to safety and the maximum time crews can spend in a cockpit and so on duty. Yes, with the disruptions, as it turned out, the fact that we were supposed to be flying by now 5 ATRs and we only fly in 2, the fact that it took about a month, not until the end of July, did we start getting the economic permissions, which is the route rights and so on, to fly the ATR into most of the territories, because that's a challenge we have here that I didn't have in places like Cal, where we got those route permissions within hours rather than here. It takes sometimes 4 weeks, as it was, so that we couldn't fly the ATR in a lot of the territories, even when we had 2 going eventually. For a lot of the time, only 1 was available to us at the start of the summer, and you mentioned the breakdown that we had in Barbados. Very unusual. It is unheard of for a brand new airplane on a brand new aircraft to go on a site, brand new engine rather, on a brand new aircraft, to have a failure that would cause an engine change. That's unheard of. It was just bad luck it happened to us, and then luckily it was picked up by our engineers before the aircraft got airborne, and therefore there was no incident, but we had to change the engine when we discovered it. So all those things added up to the fact that we then had to use Dash 8 crews that we didn't have, because we were training so many Dash 8 crews on the ATR, and they have to go all the way to France and spend 35 days there and so on for the training, and when they come back here, they can't go back to the Dash 8 because of regulatory prohibitions. They have to stay idle while we await the ATRs to come. And of course, because they have to get some cockpit time on the ATRs before they can go solo, as it were, before they're released online, something like 75 hours time, they're not building up the time because we didn't have the ATRs for them to build the time up. So we have crews idle, not building up the time to be able to fly the ATRs, having to revert to Dash 8 crews when we are very short of Dash 8 crews because we had to pull out those crews to train on the ATRs. So it's a vicious circle that we face, and it's nobody's, I'm not making excuses, it's just this is what I call the firestorm with no firebreak to recover, a perfect storm that happened to us because of all these delays and the problems with the airplanes, both the Dash 8 and the ATRs, unfortunately, when they first came in.
Problems, all kind of problems. By the way, when are those new planes finally going to be arriving? I know you've gotten, 3 of them so far?
Yes, the fourth one should be here around about the 11th of September, which is the following week. Then one in October, one in November, one in January of 2014, one in July of 2014. That's the program for the 8 airplanes so far.
Mm-hmm. Well, I want to thank you, Captain Brunton, for joining us. We're glad that you were able to clear the air on some of those issues surrounding LIAT.
Thank you, Kalilah. Thank you for your time, and I hope that the public will understand. I always, in these conversations, I apologize to them. We have failed them in the last 2 months, but it is no individual failure of planning or management. It's just a succession of unfortunate incidents that led up to this perfect storm. We will do much better in the future, and as we get more and more airplanes later on this year, we will be able to provide the product that our much beleaguered and much deserving passengers need.
As Captain Ian Brunton, CEO of LIAT Airlines, and that does it for In-Depth. Stay tuned. After the break, it's time for sports.